Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Anxious Eaters, Why We Fall for Fad Diets, by Janet Chrzan and Kima Cargill. Narrated by Rosemary Benson. Introduction. Perhaps you've had an experience like this. You're out for lunch with a friend, and you notice that he's lost weight and seems to be in very good spirits. As you review the menu, your friend explains that he can't eat much of it because he's on a special diet, and then he tells you about his new food routine in detail. You listen, rapt, since your friend is so enthusiastic, and besides, he seems to be looking pretty good, so maybe the diet works. It seems pretty complicated, however, with the need to eat particular foods and avoid other particular foods at specific times of day. It sounds like he's only eating a few foods because he needs to avoid so many, particularly carbohydrates or fats or fruits or dairy. He explains the biology of the diet and how it's rooted in deep evolutionary history, so that he's only eating foods that are specifically good for his DNA. He's returning his lifestyle to an earlier, healthier mode that ensures a clear mind, fulfilling sleep, and will avoid illness and lengthen his lifespan. He assures you that we should all be adopting this diet if we are going to be our very best selves. After that, he orders a burger, no bun, no condiments or cheese, and switches out the accompanying fries for steamed broccoli. A salad of iceberg lettuce and ranch dressing, and a dessert of gluten-free chocolate cake, and he's a happy eater. You remain a bit confused, however, about how his lunch choices reflect the diet he had explained. 2 months later, you meet again, and your friend has gained back a lot of the weight he had lost, but he's enthusiastic about another new diet, one that meshes his nutritional biology with his diurnal cycle. As it turns out, the problem with the other diet, and the reason it failed, is that he's learned it's not about what you eat, precisely, but when you eat it, and in combination with other foods. So now he's on the right course, and will be able to eat what he wants, when he wants, for life, without having to worry about his weight again. He orders gluten-free pasta with carbonara sauce and an extra order of bacon, and for dessert, creme brulee with whipped cream. He explains that he eats meat and dairy 3 days a week, with carbohydrate foods at lunch only, and can have vegetables, beans, and carbs the other days, but no gluten ever, because that's not a natural carbohydrate, but one that was bred into newer varieties of wheat that cause bloating and allergies. He seems happy and convinced, but you think his lunch looks a bit odd, and you are glad to eat your hamburger and fries. And you are a little curious about how gluten, a protein found in wheat and some other grains, turned into a carbohydrate, according to your friend. Perhaps it changed while you weren't looking? We have all had that experience with the friend who has a new diet, one that they're following enthusiastically. Or maybe we've been that friend, adopting a new diet because we learned about it from another friend, or read about it online, or in a magazine, or heard a compelling celebrity endorsement. Most such diets promise the same things: weight loss, better health, better sleep, higher mental functioning, and a general improvement in mood and affect. In other words, self-transformation. Many convince us that certain foods or food ingredients cause ill health, and that avoidance will improve a wide range of physical and mental capacities. Most also seem simple, at least at first. It's easy to avoid this food or that food, and it makes shopping so much easier just to know what to do without having to think through every single meal and food choice. These diets promise radical transformation in our lives if we just follow a few simple rules. Both authors of this book have professionally encountered such diets in their research, in their clinical work, and with the general public. Janet is a nutritional anthropologist who teaches courses in food and culture, nutrition, nutrition evolution, and other related topics. When someone hears about what she does, she is told about their latest diet, often with the desire to have the diet validated and approved of by a professional. She also has been involved in projects designed to increase vegetable and whole fruit intake, improve diets in school children, and support local farms and regional cuisines, including the creation of a farmer's market in a suburb of Philadelphia. She created the market and the educational not-for-profit that runs it to make fresh vegetables and local foods more available to the community and to support local farms and businesses. An explicit mission goal is community food education, specifically supporting healthy food choices and access. Many of her observations about the use of special diets have arisen out of the nutritional education efforts of the market and interactions with patrons at the market. A typical conversation about fad diets occurred at the market during the summer of 2018. A market customer, clearly well-spoken and well-educated, asked Janet about organic produce and bakery goods. She explained that she ate only organic food because she had a reaction to conventional foods and that she avoided all white flour and sugar because she was allergic to them. When asked, using a very neutral tone of voice, to describe the reactions and allergies, she explained that she hadn't been feeling good for a long time but didn't know why. Her daughter-in-law suggested that she switch to a popular new diet designed by a wellness expert, so she bought the recommended books and cookbooks to explore what she should be eating. The author, a diet guru, explained very clearly that the symptoms and malaise demonstrated that she wasn't eating what humans had evolved to eat. In particular, the customer stated that she was allergic to white flour and sugar, just like the book said, because she sometimes felt funny after eating a meal with bread or sweets. She had switched to whole grain bread and now avoided sugar, and her allergy was under control. She had not gone to an allergist to diagnose the problem, but had self-diagnosed. She said there was a questionnaire in the book, and she answered the questions, and it was clear she was allergic. She then explained her diet, which sounded like a typical food avoidance plan. In her case, the removal of carbohydrates, and went shopping. Her purchases consisted of a pie from the cookie baker, made with conventional white flour, white sugar, and organic berries, and a fruit-filled sweetbread made with mixed grains, some white, from the bread maker. When asked if she had found what she needed for her special diet, she said yes. She found the right foods and that she wouldn't be eating any vegetables or fruit from the market because she wasn't sure if they were organic. She left the market happy and left Janet confused by how a seemingly sensible woman had not only adopted a diet that didn't make sense, but had then happily purchased food not part of the diet, convinced that they represented what she should eat. We've all been this well-meaning woman when we've fallen for what looked like scientific claims that promised to solve a problem we didn't fully understand but badly wanted to remedy. Another example is an interaction with a local contractor who heard about a diet where you eat the foods that people did a long time ago and it cures cancer. He couldn't remember the name of it. He read all about it online, but it started with a P. When Janet suggested paleo, he affirmed that was the name. When told that paleo diets don't cure cancer, he argued and said that he read online from lots of people whose cancer was cured by eating the diet. When asked if those were sites that sold dietary supplements, and ingredients for paleo. He again affirmed and wanted to know what Janet thought of the diet before he started buying what they offered. In this case, the promise of avoiding or curing a much-feared disease was reason enough to try the diet and even to buy products. He did, however, agree that testimonials on a sales website might be distorted in favor of the item being offered, but still was convinced, given what he had read, that somehow the diet probably prevented cancer, because, according to him, people didn't have cancer in the past. These are not solitary examples. Situations of this sort have occurred with numerous community members and customers at the market, and demonstrate that knowledge about food, diets, health, and nutrition is idiosyncratic, riddled with cognitive dissonance, but also emblematic of the American understanding of food intake and the self. More often than not, the desire to adopt such a diet is tied to avoidance of illness as much as it is to the creation of a slim body. Above all, interactions of this sort made Janet wonder what was going on with these eaters and how such dietary patterns of behavior fit into the big tent of food culture within the United States. Kima is a professor of clinical psychology who teaches the psychology of food and culture, as well as consumerism and its effects on well-being. Kima's previous scholarship has examined how overeating is influenced by living in an affluent culture focused on consuming. She views appetite as not only a biological drive, but also a broader desire to consume material goods, luxury experiences, food, medications, and alcohol. She also focuses on how the food and pharmaceutical industries use psychology to trick us into consuming more by distorting scientific information, sowing nutritional confusion, resisting regulation, and convincing us that the solution to the ills of overconsumption is more consumption. In her clinical psychology practice, Kima often learns about nutritional practices and fad diets adopted by her patients in order to lose weight, improve fertility, or address perceived allergies. Our collaboration and this volume began accidentally when Janet was asked to peer-review Kima's book, The Psychology of Overeating. In Kima's clinical work, she often interacts with patients who struggle with weight or have difficult relationships with food. In trying to understand why her patients were having trouble with consumption of consumer goods as well as food, Kima explored the magical belief systems that they adopted to rationalize their actions. One patient relied on a series of fad diets to control her weight, albeit unsuccessfully, and was particularly convinced that going gluten-free would solve her myriad somatic problems. Kima wrote about how Allison saw a gluten-free diet as a kind of magic bullet that would fix, with one simple action, her mental and bodily health problems. And in an early draft of the book manuscript, Kima made a very easy mistake, for someone who isn't a nutritionist, that is. She described gluten as a carbohydrate. This makes perfect sense because going gluten-free means avoiding wheat, the most popular and prevalent source of carbohydrates in the United States. Cognitively, we often identify wheat as a carb, and thus, if something in the wheat is causing a problem, that problem must also be a carb, right? It makes perfect sense, given how our brains mentally map the world around us. But it's incorrect, because gluten is a protein. In fact, it's a springy one that allows breads to rise and provide that toothy loft that marks a really tasty, well-made loaf. Gluten stretches to accommodate the air bubbles that cause the bread to rise, because protein elongates far better than carbohydrate. Without gluten, you'd have a cracker, not a slice of bread. Janet flagged this small mistake, Kima fixed it, and we then started talking about how food beliefs and practices are shaped by cultural norms, by what we know or think we know, and by what we don't know. We also realized that we shared a fascination with dietary behavior and had significant clinical and participant observational experience in what people eat, why they eat it, and how it affects health, both mental and physical. We often discussed the dietary fads that we heard about from subjects and patients so that together we could provide a greater understanding of why such diets were adopted by such a wide variety of people. This conversation has continued for years and is a source of real inspiration to both of us since we approach our knowledge of food from different academic disciplines. Whereas Janet is a nutritional anthropologist trained in human biology, nutrition, and medical anthropology, Kima's specialty within psychology is the cultural origins of psychological disorders with a training background in psychoanalytic and existential theory. We realized that each of us holds a piece of the puzzle we title, Why Do People Follow Fad Diets? And that by comparing our notes about clinical experiences, dieters' behavior, academic theory, and methods, we could triangulate the question to create a far more contextualized cultural map of why people choose such diets. There is no single definition of a fad diet, but we generally understand a fad diet to be a novelty diet that makes big promises and often has little scientific evidence supporting it, or in many cases, is supported by debunked science or pseudo-scientific claims. The Pennington Biomedical Research Group defines fad diets as ones that ask the user to eliminate one or several food groups, promise quick results, such as 5 or more pounds of weight loss a week, use personal testimonies as proof of effectiveness, use only certain or special foods that claim to offer advantages for weight loss, recommend supplements or pills as part of the diet, are endorsed or advertised by a celebrity, sound too good to be true. We would add that, like fashion fads, fad diets are a form of collective behavior that develop within a culture, a generation, or social group, and that people follow enthusiastically for a somewhat short period. All dietary practices these days, whether perennial diets such as vegetarianism or more recent fad diets such as clean eating, have sizable online communities and cultures that allow for the viral spread of trendy behaviors and practices. An important element contributing to fad diet popularity is the charisma and appeal of their founders. It's easy to be snarky about how diet originators benefit from their diets. They often make a lot of money from books, consulting, and paid talks. But they also become important cultural figures, health VIPs who command attention and accolades. Authority is granted through endorsements by celebrities, appearances on television chat shows, podcasts, and other media, and the acceptance and approval of friends who follow and promote the diet and lifestyle. The mere fact that they have produced a book signals to many people, especially those who don't understand the ease of self-publication, that the authors are reliable and knowledgeable. Because how can you get a volume published if the information within isn't accurate? In addition, their messages are deeply hopeful, and they guarantee that their diets will improve the lives of all who follow. The proponents often promise improved health and wellness and provide glowing testimonials from followers to support their diet protocols. They also become icons of aspiration. Just think of the appeal of Gwyneth Paltrow, She's famous, beautiful, financially successful, and has a lovely family. Some are considered to be prophets or gurus by their followers, especially when they attribute their health and success to religious or spiritual guidance. Indeed, the appeal of merely getting rich may pale in comparison to the attainment of social and cultural accolades and success. The charisma and aspirational promises of these gurus make them profoundly appealing in general, especially to those who are worried about health, appearance, or living their best life. Following these diets promises so very much, from health and wellness to wealth and social success. It's astonishing, frankly, that fad diets aren't even more popular than they seem to be. In the process of discussing and comparing disciplinary findings, we realized something surprising, something we even found intellectually perverse. Fad diets make cultural sense. Fad diets aren't a product of ignorance, lazy or wishful thinking, or purposeful mendacity, although sometimes all of these occur as well. They are a product of deep and enduring cultural and psychological processes and needs. When examined within a cultural system, they are rational. Not only that, but every fad diet expresses important cultural tropes and belief systems that make it a functional and sensible example of social, cultural, and psychological programming. Even if the diets don't make much biological sense, they make cultural sense and fulfill psychological needs. So they persist. Fad diets are behaviors designed to calm an accompanying set of concerns or anxieties. These might be concrete anxieties about weight, body size, or food safety. Or they might be broader existential anxieties about social status, aging, virility, or fertility. If you are familiar with obsessive-compulsive disorder, then you already know that it's an anxiety disorder in which fears, obsessions, are accompanied by behaviors, compulsions, that are designed to calm the fears. A person who fears contamination might compulsively wash or disinfect objects to calm their anxieties. The compulsive behaviors work as a kind of treatment or talisman to manage the internal distress. We aren't suggesting that fad dieting is a clinical disorder. However, there is a similar psychology at play. Our subjective distresses channel themselves into dietary behaviors that are meant to calm and organize the self. Finally, we should add that we are not exempt from fads. While we try to maintain objective, scientific distance, we're also rank-and-file members of this culture and often wish for the same easy solutions and quick fixes as everyone else. We would also do well to remember that, above all, fad diets serve as heuristics, that is, mental shortcuts or systems to simplify what has become a complex and confusing behavior: eating. The magic bullet effect. Many fad diets make extravagant promises about results, assuring users that the relatively small effort of adhering to a seemingly easy diet will pay off with outsized results in multiple areas of life, from physical appearance to mental functioning and longevity. The process is depicted as a unidirectional cause and effect relationship, usually with few side effects or risks. We think of such promises as magic bullets. They argue that the adherent needs to do only one simple act, such as take a pill, avoid a certain food, or practice a behavior, and the results are guaranteed to solve the problem, however defined. Most importantly, there is rarely any mention of possible negative outcomes or even outcomes that don't work at all. The name for this type of thinking originated in a German story from the Renaissance, a tale about a marksman who owned magic bullets that hit the target every time he fired, without fail. Hundreds of years later, the phrase magic bullet entered the medical lexicon, signifying a drug or treatment able to selectively cure disease with no harmful side effects. But note that in the original tale, the marksman acquired the magic bullets from the devil, who retained the final bullet for his sole use. Ultimately, that final bullet could be used against the marksman. That is, the magic bullet contained a hidden cost. This darker side of the folktale was forgotten when the phrase entered the popular medical lexicon. The belief in magic bullets expresses our deep-seated desires for powerful, simple solutions to complex problems, such as cancer or a slim body, as well as our longing for self-transformation. But just as that final bullet couldn't be controlled by the hunter, these solutions don't always hit their mark. Fad diets are just one of the many cultural practices that challenge our wishes for easy, seemingly cost-free solutions, expressing desires for self-transformation and relief from anxiety, often outside of our self-awareness. Indeed, one of the core attributes of most fad diets is the promise of a simple fix to the problem of diet-induced fat, ill health, or general malaise, as numerous critics have illustrated. For example, C. Levinovitz, who is particularly helpful when contemplating how mythology validates diets, and Warner, who illustrates how pseudoscience encourages magic bullet thinking. A simple perusal of your email account's spam bucket will turn up numerous offers for the perfect easy diet, similar to much of the clickbait that shows up on your social media newsfeed. The allure of something for nothing, or in this case, losing weight and achieving perfect health for minimal effort, is hard to resist. Our minds know it can't be true, yet we hope that maybe this diet, this time, will remove that pesky extra 20 pounds. In this volume, we will examine fad diets from the perspectives of nutrition, anthropology, and psychology to explain why such diets are popular and how they help users manage anxieties about food choice and offer the promise of self-transformation. While most studies of dietary practices focus on the content of the diet and how it affects the bodies and social lives of adherents, this book will instead explore the cultural correlates for diet popularity. In other words, we aim to understand the cultural and economic context of diets, as well as their psychological appeal for the individual. Diets, particularly fad diets, do not appear and become culturally salient in a vacuum. Diets, bodily practices, and nutritional belief systems are created by culturally determined narratives, often designed to affect self-transformation through elitism, identity, or rituals of purification. As such, they meet psychological yearnings and rationales, operate through cultural systems that condition use patterns and legitimize practice, and affect biological bodies individually and collectively. Yet they are almost always of their time and place, and they are subject to social and cultural change as belief systems shift in response to perceptions of nutritional science and appropriate bodily practice. While individuals feel that they choose specific diets for reasons that are personal, in fact, the diet is available to them because of social systems that harness cultural narratives to channel acceptance and behavior to make the diet physically, economically, and perceptually rational. It's worth repeating that the forces that make diets available are often outside of our awareness, even though we often feel that our dietary choices are individual and rational. While we do comment on the nutritional wisdom of many diets, Our primary aim is to explore their popularity and functionality in relation to culture, nutrition, and individual psychological needs. We present an analysis of dietary practice and belief designed to provide the listener with the means to better understand why specific diets are popular among the American population. We want to answer the questions, why this diet and why now? Moreover, the book will arm the listener with a critical method to understand future fad diets in sociocultural and psychological context. Every era is marked by specific dietary regimes that reflect broader cultural and historical trends in understanding the body, the self, and social relationships. We will explore how these bodily practices and belief systems represent and express a culturally and historically situated self, and why parsimonious solutions such as eat less food are less attractive than diets that are more esoteric and arbitrary. We'll ask if this nutritional confusion is a product of our culture, and if so, how can we use cultural and personal practices and beliefs to better understand why we choose to follow diet fads and what we expect them to do for us. We should also note that dietary behaviors, especially those connected to fad diets, are nearly always social behavior. Even in our clinical practices, we rarely learn about private dietary behavior, except in cases of disordered eating. The diets we discuss in this volume are all named, often branded, and practiced in public, social ways. There is a performative aspect to these diets that distinguishes them from private bodily practices and makes us understand them as cultural and relational. More specifically, as people increasingly have social lives online and craft online identities, we also see the ways in which web influencers shape people's beliefs and behaviors about diet. In fact, it seems to us that most people choose their diets not based on their own intuition or taste preferences, but because of how they are socially influenced by people they know in person, or, increasingly, online. As you learn more about the subtle, unconscious ways in which your diet is influenced by your cultural context, you might find yourself asking, now what? We're not arguing that people have no free will or control over their dietary choices. Quite the contrary. Much of the discipline of psychology is based on the premise that creating a conscious awareness of our choices and behaviors leads to growth and positive change. This was Freud's essential belief and is the underlying premise of most forms of psychotherapy. We wholeheartedly believe that increased awareness of how fad diets work and the common pseudoscientific principles they employ liberates us from their grip. The organization of this volume. In addition to the introductory chapters and conclusion, four chapters focus on particular diet types: food removal, food addiction, clean eating, and paleo primal. We've clustered the diets in this way because they share similar belief systems and practices, and in some cases they have simply been recycled with new names over the years. These chapters include a description of the diet and its practices, why it's attractive, a discussion of the popular or cultural concepts that are expressed through the diet, and an analysis of the psychological and social reasons for its popularity. Food removal. Food removal diets generally limit one macronutrient believed to cause excess weight and obesity, such as the Atkins diet and other low or no-carb diets. More recently, avoidance of simple sugars, monosaccharides and disaccharides, or simple carbohydrates such as glucose, fructose, and galactose has morphed into a popular avoidance of white sugar and sweeteners of all types. Currently popular anti-carb or anti-sugar diets often advocate the removal of all simple carbohydrates and sharply limit intake of complex carbohydrates, asserting that carbohydrates are linked to many health problems from overweight to cancer. These diets often result in quick weight loss caused by caloric restriction. But the fat loss is rarely sustainable, nor is the diet balanced enough for long-term health. The reasons for failure are biological as well as social. The cultural constructs that allow us to consider food good to eat determine social eating and food rules, and food restriction makes it difficult to eat with other people. Our eating patterns are socially constructed and enacted, and humans have a long history of cooking and sharing food as a core behavioral characteristic. As such, the individual dietary choices most of us are familiar with are quite new in the history of human cultural behavior. Whereas what's good to eat is socially determined, until recently, almost all food considered good to eat for the group was also considered edible for an individual. This new era of personal choice may be liberating, but it is also confusing. What Jean-Paul Sartre called being condemned to freedom. Individuals no longer rely upon long-held cultural wisdom about diet, and instead, many of us now constitute food rules seemingly de novo, much like how modern parenting is now often learned in isolation through books and blogs by new parents who are geographically isolated from extended kinship networks. So too have cooking, diet, and food choice become individual and isolated. Yet the maintenance and defense of individual dietary choice limit shared group experiences and render many food restriction diets impossible to sustain. This chapter also addresses how options for diets relying on macronutrient restriction create seemingly easy psychological and biological solutions, a form of wishful thinking that embraces nutritionism to reduce the value of foods to a single, defining nutrient. Food removal diets can be understood within a historical context of moral panics surrounding food and drugs. For example, absinthe, alcohol, marijuana, fat, sugar, etc., that create a demonized commodity that must be exorcised from the body to restore individual and social morality. Such moral panics typically emerge from a strong internal locus of control, typical of Westerners, and especially Americans, and espouse a cultural goal of conquering and mastering nature, self, and destiny. Food addiction. Food addicts believe that an ingredient within food is toxic or intolerable to some people. The toxicity or intolerance may be expressed by a negative biological reaction, an allergic reaction, or an addiction process that simultaneously harms while, in some cases, creating overwhelming cravings similar to alcohol among alcoholics. Diets followed by those in recovery as food addicts often avoid wheat products, sugars, and individual trigger foods. What makes recovery diets different from carb avoidance is the popular belief that wheat products and sugars cause a negative biophysical reaction in some people. Rather than asserting that all wheat is bad for all people, this set of diets posits that some people have a problem, sensitivity, allergy, or addiction, with some types of food ingredients. This is not to deny that food allergies exist and are very dangerous to some people, but there is a folk construction about food allergies, sensitivities, and addictions that differs from biomedical diagnoses and symptomatology of the condition. Additionally, The people who believe, through self-diagnosis, that they are allergic or sensitive to specific food elements often also believe that they are addicted to them. While this may seem a mutually incompatible belief, it is in fact a rational construction within American culture because of the popularity of Alcoholics Anonymous, the primary treatment paradigm for addictions. A long-standing explanation for alcoholism among followers of AA is that alcoholics possess an allergy to alcohol that damages them, but that non-alcoholics are free of this problem. In this construction, the allergy or addiction creates an insatiable craving that is not felt by non-alcoholics. In the publications of diet proponents, the notion of the uniquely dangerous yet addictively craved food substance is very common, indicating that the cultural construction of addiction adopted by AA has deep cultural resonance. These fears often center on essentialized components of food, with the assumption of allergy or addiction linked to specific compounds or molecules within the food source. We explore the rise of affliction diets through the lens of medical anthropology, examining folk medicine traditions that link affliction to the ability to heal. Shamanism, secondary to survival of an illness, is present in almost all cultures and provides medical legitimacy in many traditions. For example, in the United States, Alcoholics Anonymous posits that only those in recovery can help the currently afflicted. That people believe experience lends credibility to healing processes is clear when analyzing the published texts about food addictions. Many of these accounts incorporate a personal narrative of affliction and recovery, leading to a better life, lifestyle, and so forth for those selling books, diet products, and treatment therapies. Indeed, such patterns are endemic to much of the writing about weight loss in the United States and exemplify the medical anthropology theories that explain the afflicted shaman cultural trope. They also reflect popular American Alcoholics Anonymous and temperance narratives that frame a descent into addiction, degradation, and disease with an arc of redemption. The sufferer begins whole and healthy, descends into social and physical corruption, and then, by abjuring the addictive and dangerous substance, returns to social acceptance and physical health. Addiction, affliction, allergy diets are appealing because they offer a single theory that explains all of our problems. For example, people sometimes blame wheat for panic attacks, fatigue, migraines, and ADHD. But even more appealing than a single explanation for all of our ills is a single solution. Removing a single ingredient, like wheat, illustrates the magic bullet approach. Such magical thinking may exert a kind of temporary placebo effect that mitigates symptoms, but is unlikely to last, if for no other reason than that such diets are difficult for most people to maintain indefinitely. Diets following an addiction model often have parallels to cults and cult behavior, in that there is frequently a guru or charismatic leader offering salvation to those who suffer the same affliction. This chapter will draw this parallel via scholarship by psychologists and anthropologists who have studied cults and cult behavior. Clean eating. The clean eating movement consists of a set of dietary behaviors and practices designed to decrease intake of substances considered to be dangerous additives in food and increase the intake of foods that are whole, natural, organic, and unprocessed. Many adherents of clean eating, including those who have adopted the Whole 30 and similar diets, also abjure white sugars, wheat products, and other foods they consider harmful to the body. In this way, The clean eating movement overlaps with diets that restrict categories of macronutrients, eliminate gluten, advocate for vegetarian or vegan dietary regimes, or promote a paleo or constructed old-fashioned diet perceived to reflect evolutionary physical needs. Clean eating is often linked to other bodily practices designed to protect the individual from harmful environmental toxins or to promote well-being, such as detoxing, yoga, massage, alternative medicine, and other regimes of self-care. The practice of clean eating can be relatively innocuous and in harmony with sensible and orthodox nutritional advice, but it can also tip into orthorexia, an eating disorder defined by an obsessive need to consume only healthy foods. Clean eating is ultimately a means to control anxiety about dietary intakes, food safety, and health. Consuming food can be scary, and choosing the right foods can become a disorienting and frightening task in a world with seemingly unlimited choices, especially when that world is also considered to be environmentally polluted and potentially dangerous. In that context, clean eating channels anxiety by providing food rituals that, when followed, allow the adherent to feel that she is doing everything possible to protect herself from environmental contaminants and ill health. This concept of bodily purity, where the body serves as a barrier to the influx of harmful outside influences, is a common construct in many cultures. Indeed, the belief in the sanctity of the body is so strong in the West that it has determined much of the theory and practice of Western medicine. As such, it's an unexamined, fully accepted reality for most people, resulting in a feeling of great distress if and when the porosity of the body is revealed. Indeed, many cultures adopt food rituals, such as fasting, specifically designed to control the interpenetration of the body and world. These rituals become part of a culture's construction of what is good to eat and how it should be prepared, consumed, and discarded. We examine theories of the body and the body's relationship to the environment to help listeners think through the relationship of their bodies to the outside world and to decrease anxiety about eating. Food rituals, both social and personal, are adopted for many psychological reasons, and specific food practices designed to alleviate anxiety and fears are appealing to those who are worried about diet and health. Many diets promise to make users healthier, ensure longevity, promote fertility, etc., to protect them from perceived contaminants in the environment, or to ensure that their food and their bodies remain in a state of self-defined purity. Ethnographic accounts of clean eaters and juicers have shown that adherents may start such diets to feel pure or in control, and then often wind up feeling superior to others by virtue of their dietary choices. Such social emotions will be explored, along with how such diets are used as a talisman against broader existential threats, such as global warming, food safety, and corporate malfeasance in the food industry. Paleo or primal diet. The very popular Paleolithic diet encourages consumers to eat foods or their modern near equivalents that pre-agricultural Paleolithic humans might have eaten. The rationale is that our bodies haven't evolved as quickly as our agricultural and food systems have modernized, and that humans are not genetically equipped for a modern diet. Paleo enthusiasts argue that much of modern degenerative disease is caused by modern foods, and that we can restore ourselves to a state of pre-agricultural health by a return to an older diet. Unfortunately, a reconstruction of ancient diet is difficult because of archaeological processes that obscure food materials, as well as the omnivorous nature of our species. Regardless, many dieters believe that a paleo diet is the only way to maintain weight and stay healthy. Certainly, some elements of an imagined paleo diet have nutritional merit as well as archaeological validity, but because of the scientific difficulty of determining what our ancestors ate, defining a true paleo diet is impossible. In this chapter, we demonstrate how an imagined golden past channels the performance of social roles and promotes popular acceptance of diet regimes. In the case of the paleo diet, the foods allow for the construction of a biological, often racial and gendered, identity that proposes a need for a recreation or return to a golden age of health and nutrition. This chapter will also examine the evolutionary importance of how food was prepared and eaten by early hominids, because paleoanthropological research demonstrates that fire and food sharing probably played a more important role in evolution than did specific foods. We'll explore the methods and theories used to understand the past and the evolutionary pathways that led to our present biocultural health patterns. This discussion allows us to refocus ideas about Paleolithic diets from the nutritional content of foods to the social and environmental context of early diets, and to better understand the importance of an omnivorous diet to our species. We further examine the appeal of this cluster of diets and how it expresses ambivalence about civilization's taming of human beings. Paleo diets are often practiced alongside other perceived caveman behaviors and lifestyle choices that express a wish to return to humanity's natural state. Such wishes may express existential anxieties connected to urbanization and technology, such that accessing a more primitive part of the self functions as a talisman against these threats of the modern world. This chapter will review the anthropological and nutritional evidence for ancient diets, and will then explore how and why so many people reject the scientific facts in favor of an imagined, perhaps even idealized, past. We outline strategies for navigating the disparate and often overly authoritative messages about the ideal diet. Final thoughts. Our agenda is ambitious, but at the same time, it is very simple: to show that fad diets make sense. Every culture constructs beliefs about what is good to eat, to teach members how to stay healthy, nourish themselves, fit in with the group, and, hopefully, enjoy their meals. Historically, these cuisines and the patterns of production and belief that underpin them often existed to manage food scarcity rather than food abundance. But we now live in a globalized world marked by abundance of food, matched with a developed market for branded commercial food products. This situation leads to conflicting information about what's good to eat, and ultimately to confusion and anxiety in consumers. This problem is especially prevalent in a neoliberal economy in which eaters absorb the message that they are solely responsible for their health and well-being, via good or bad choices, and that food choice and proper body management are the foundation of good health. Free will, discipline, and the elevation and control of the bounded, rational self undergird this paradigm and influence our thinking in ways we often don't recognize. Medical anthropology provides a rich analysis of how concepts about bodily control, control of the self, and the inviolate self all contribute to health states. Similarly, the idea of control has particular resonance in the United States, where the good citizen is posited to be the fully in control of self citizen. However, for every action that indicates control, the individual often grants the self an opportunity for loss of control. There is an uneasy back and forth between rigidly upholding behavior patterns that promote the ideal and losing it in rituals of release and subversion. What happens in Vegas stays in Vegas is not just a pithy phrase, but can become a rationale for actions that negate good intentions, known in psychology as moral licensing. The cycle of control and loss of control has a deep history cross-culturally, in which rituals of reversal, or inversion, are marked as special times for license and excess. Management of these cultural patterns and expectations, especially in relation to food, requires self-knowledge, and yes, some amount of self-control, which can create cognitive dissonance and anxiety. Managing control is especially difficult in a modern culture in which adherence to the holy grail of self-control seems to have become all-important and self-defining. To make sense of these messages and the dizzying abundance of food, we have developed numerous means to channel food choice through practical implementation of primary information about control, status, health, identity, purity, and medical efficacy. The wellness and self-care industries are only the tip of the iceberg in this messaging, much of it commercial, about what we ought to eat to promote personal health and the health of the planet and our communities. How can consumers navigate these thickets sanely and effectively? How can eaters evaluate dietary messages and prescriptions to promote a good diet? Above all, how can consumers adopt practices that manage the inherent anxiety created by constantly having to choose and choose correctly? Keep listening. Chapter 1. Why We Love Fad Diets. From the outset, we knew we wanted to organize this book around specific fad diets, like paleo and clean eating. For most people, a diet is a belief system about food, often named or branded, that they imagine they have freely chosen and put into practice. We knew that organizing this book around recognizable, popular diets would make the most intuitive sense to listeners. Yet, as we wrote, we found ourselves often repeating our ideas chapter after chapter, and this repetition reinforced one of our strongest observations. The same fears, beliefs, and fantasies underpin nearly all diets, even when the diets appear radically different. That is the central argument of this book, that all fad diets are driven by the same engine of wishes and fantasies that repeat themselves not only across diets, but also across historical eras. Rather than repeat these themes and ideas in every chapter, we've chosen to discuss in this first chapter the key concepts that explain the general appeal of fad diets and some of the universal truths underlying all of them. We draw from food studies, an interdisciplinary and expansive field that incorporates history, sociology, anthropology, psychology, geography, economics, and other disciplines. Here we briefly introduce some of the major scholars and texts relevant to each concept. Later, in the diet chapters, we will select the most salient themes and apply them to the specific diet in question, with the goal of moving listeners toward thinking like anthropologists and psychologists with regard to diet culture and behavior. Americans and fad diets. Americans are more interested in diets than people from many other cultures, and are more likely to consider their diet a significant part of their identity. Americans have a strong sense of rights related to freedom and liberty, especially freedom from and freedom to. Freedom from indicates that individual actions won't be constrained by obstacles, social, political, or cultural, while freedom to expresses the individual's right to act, including in his or her own interest. While these concepts are deeply social, cultural, and legal, many Americans see them as largely concerning the self and the rights of the individual, that is, as a guarantee of self-determination. Nowhere have we seen this attitude more clearly than in the recent mask-wearing culture wars of the coronavirus pandemic. These beliefs can devolve into a conviction that one has the right not to be constrained and the right to do as one pleases. This idea of the highly individualized self accompanies the belief in and wish for self-actualization, transformation, and autonomy. That is, the ability of the individual to alter both the self and the contextualizing world. Americans are highly individualized, and many view the individual self as a lifelong project of improvement and perfection. We can see evidence for Americans' prioritization of personal growth and self-transformation in the popularity of self-help books, therapy, and makeover shows. This belief in the power of personal growth depends on the idea that we can control our behavior, tame our bodies, and manipulate our personal fortunes and destinies. These might seem like universal or innate personality characteristics, yet they are actually quite unique and culturally specific. Many people around the world do not see themselves as in control of their fate, and instead see themselves as at the mercy of larger economic, cultural, and environmental forces. The freedom to choose one's own spouse, profession, or home, for example, is foreign to a great many people on the planet. By contrast, most Americans believe that individuals have sole power over their success in life or over their destiny. When the Pew Research Center recently surveyed people in 44 countries, 57% of Americans disagreed with the statement that success in life is pretty much determined by forces outside our control. That's a higher percentage than in most other nations, and far above the global median of 38%. In fact, according to the political historian Daniel Rogers, the American belief in personal control over the world even increased during the last few decades, as conceptions of human nature that in the post-World War II era had been thick with context, social circumstance, institutions, and history gave way to conceptions of human nature that stressed choice, agency, performance, and desire. Strong metaphors of society were supplanted by weaker ones. Imagined collectivities shrank. Notions of structure and power thinned out. Such cultural shifts away from the collective and toward the individualistic reveal that many Americans would refute the idea that no man is an island, that no one is truly self-sufficient, and that everyone must rely on others to thrive. A later chapter will show that social influences over the self are repeatedly rejected in rationalizations for adopting the paleo diet, especially by men who belong to alt-right or men's rights groups. The desire to dominate is often linked to a belief in an essentialist caveman nature as part of their construction of ideal masculinity. Psychologists refer to locus of control, that is, the degree to which people believe that they exert control over the outcome of events. People with strong internal locus of control tend to believe that the events in their lives are determined by their own actions, willpower, self-determination, and merit. People with a strong external locus of control attribute events to outside forces beyond their control. For example, when receiving exam results, people with a strong internal locus of control are likely to attribute their grade to their intelligence or studying, whereas those with an external locus of control are likely to view the teacher or the testing conditions as the reason for their grade. While there is wide variation among Americans on locus of control, as for any personality characteristic, the Pew study indicates that Americans may have the strongest internal locus of control of any culture in the world. Naturally, this fact has implications for how Americans view diet, nutrition, and the body. Locus of control has been studied extensively by health psychologists. The Dieting Beliefs Scale assesses expectations about whether weight is determined by factors outside one's control, such as luck or genes, versus the expectation that one can control one's own weight through willpower and effort. Researchers have not proven this empirically, but based on what we do know about dieting beliefs and culturally mediated locus of control, we suspect that Americans have a very strong weight internal locus of control. If we did not, how could we explain the billion-dollar diet industry? We buy diet books, join weight loss programs, and eat special foods because we believe that these are tools that will help us change ourselves. History helps us understand how and why Americans embrace fad diets, as Warren Belasco has demonstrated with his masterful books, Appetite for Change, How the Counterculture Took on the Food Industry, and Food, the Key Concepts. The latter introduces readers to important ideas in food studies and outlines the unique relationship that Americans seem to have with obesity and dieting, reminding readers that we annually spend an enormous amount of time and money on diets. Belasco attributes this obsession with dieting to core American cultural traits, such as belief in individual perfectibility and willpower, the ability to control nature, and the priority of youth. A mechanistic view of the body, the Protestant work ethic, and faith in consumer capitalism. Together, these attributes point to a cultural belief system that sees the body as infinitely malleable, that makes an individual naturally responsible for his or her bodily shape, and indeed morally culpable if not appropriately and youthfully thin. And because Americans believe in the capacity of purchased goods and services to solve problems, create identity, and craft the body, it is inevitable that diets arise out of consumer processes and structures. A diet does not exist on its own, free of purchasable goods and concepts. It is created and validated by the books, ad-filled blogs, diet amendments, products, and retail foods that constitute its consumerism. Without the option to purchase and create self-identity through brand allegiance, the diet might have no meaning and thus no followers. So, a diet is not just a set of behaviors, but a belief system, a consumer product, and a social identity. Many other scholars have discussed the history of fad diets in the United States, such as Harvey Levenstein, whose Fear of Food chronicles the history of food scares in the United States and the resulting dietary beliefs and practices designed to protect the individual from these collective dangers. Levenstein categorizes various food scares into epistemological groups and cycles that wax and wane in the intensity of belief in them and in relation to public awareness of food contamination problems. Arising out of his earlier historical examinations of food use in the Americas, such as Revolution at the Table, The Transformation of the American Diet, and Paradox of Plenty, A Social History of Eating in Modern America, the linkages Levenstein describes in Fear of Food demonstrate the wild gyrations of dietary belief and practice, and show how these beliefs and practices have been shaped by the natural bounty of the so-called New World and the public's understanding of how health, disease, and diet are connected. In his analysis, the newness and the possibilities, as well as abundance, of the New World diet have led to dietary extremes and to the latest and more faddish dietary plans to combat excess weight. The commercial aspect of the diet business is also explored by the historian Hillel Schwartz in Never Satisfied, A Cultural History of Diets, Fantasies, and Fat, one of the first academic accounts of American fad diets. In his examination of fat, ideas about weight, and dieting, Schwartz states that diets seem to appear out of nowhere, in no time at all, like barbarians or wandering saints, and they seem to disappear as easily and swiftly as they come. This constant search for the purchasable new remedy is the qualifying characteristic of American diets, because they are inevitably linked to a diet industry that promotes them as the newest and best means to solve the problem of excess weight. Schwartz makes clear that diets are always tied to the opportunity to sell. Ideas via books and consulting service, nostrums marked as medicine, and food products designed to replace the presumably fat-inducing analogs. He sums up this situation as a tumultuous fairground of diets, diet foods, diet drinks, diet books, diet doctors, drugs, and devices, many of which are recycled from decade to decade, given new names, new promoters, and seemingly new opportunities for weight reduction. In the United States, several cultural variables have converged to favor the growth of the diet industry, including the abundance of food, in comparison with the old world, a culture that believes in self-control and individual responsibility, and widespread faith in the market to solve almost all problems, personal or social. These variables constitute the perfect set of ingredients to ensure the growth of the for-profit diet market and its attendant need for new, ever-changing fad diets. Dietary and national exceptionalism. But is the United States exceptional? Some Americans, especially politicians, call the United States exceptional, although that word and its meanings differ depending on the individual's political persuasion and educational experiences. Certainly, the American diet is exceptional. An abundance of available food has been a defining feature since the colonial period. Many authors, both academic and popular, link the current high rates of excess weight and obesity to what is often labeled SAD, or the standard American diet, clearly indicating that our diet is different and exceptional, even in comparison to diets of other advanced industrialized nations. However, there is now increasing evidence that many other countries have begun to catch up with the United States, both in dietary habits and in rates of excess weight and obesity. Critiques of the SAD, such an evocative acronym, are rampant among diet gurus. A simple internet search for the term reveals thousands of results, with the first 10 pages demonstrating little or nothing that supports or advocates for the SAD. All reviews are negative, and some use the concept to sell diets, such as paleo, Atkins, or something similar that is assured to reverse the damages attributed to SAD. The idea that the national diet is somehow problematic has become so normalized that it is rarely questioned, and descriptions of SAD veer into the hysterically negative. Even within clinical dietetics, The unequivocal denunciation of our diet is paramount, as demonstrated by the opening paragraph of a peer-reviewed and invited review from the well-respected journal Nutrition in Clinical Practice. The origins of the Western diet, also referred to as the Standard American Diet, SAD, can be traced back more than 10,000 years to the Neolithic period. It was during this time that agriculture and animal husbandry evolved, resulting in increases in animal and grain consumption. Today's Western diet, or SAD, generally refers to a total diet pattern, with multicultural variations, that includes excess consumption of calories from refined carbohydrates, fatty meats, and added fats, and that lacks many nutrients found in whole grains, fruits, and vegetables. This dietary pattern, which also includes excess sodium intake, has been blamed for contributing to our current staggering levels of overweight and obesity, as well as diet-related diseases and conditions such as type 2 diabetes mellitus, hypertension, and heart disease. This paragraph defines SAD as high in meat, fat, carbohydrates, and sodium, and it blames the development of agriculture and animal husbandry for the current state of obesity. In other words, this critique stresses the contents of food rather than the context of the diet. We are fat because our food is bad, rather than we are fat because of a series of complex interlinking patterns that contribute to excess intake and decreased activity. Given such blanket condemnations within academia and professional practice, it is easy to understand why concerned citizens and diet gurus so comfortably reject individual foods or components of foods. Once the sin, as it were, is located in the essence of the food item, the only response can be to abjure it completely. The review just quoted borrows heavily from the even more prestigious article by Cordain et al. From the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition, which presents a far more contextualized and complicated relationship between modern obesity and disease. However, the authors also assert that, in the United States and most Western countries, diet-related chronic diseases represent the single largest cause of morbidity and mortality. These diseases are epidemic in contemporary westernized populations and typically afflict 50 to 65% of the adult population. Yet they are rare or non-existent in hunter-gatherers and other less westernized people. The solution is simple, it seems. We must adopt a diet different from SAD, preferably one from the past, whatever it might be. The stage is set for validating the Paleolithic diet and other fad diets that advocate for the avoidance of specific food items or macronutrients. Of course, there is some validity to this criticism of the American diet. These diet-promoting authors echo the themes of many other authors who critique the modern food system, such as Michael Pollan, Barry Glasner, Barry Popkin, Michael Moss, Marion Nessel, and Mark Schatzker. There are problems with our food system, and there is a higher percentage of obese individuals in the United States than in all other high-income industrialized countries, with a national average of 39.8%. The United States has the highest rate of obesity among Organization for Cooperation and Development nations. The OECD average is 19.5%, with Japan at the low end with 3.7%, France at 15.3%, and the United Kingdom at 26.9%. The reasons for these statistics are extremely complex, however, and are not the focus of this book. Obesity in the United States is related to myriad factors, including the lack of a unifying food culture, sedentism, and agricultural subsidies, and the resulting excess production of commodity crops. Moreover, the power of the food companies and lobbies ensures that the regulation of advertisements and even school lunch menus can be politically and culturally fraught. Adiposity is connected to the sheer abundance that promotes increased intake, from ever larger portion sizes to multiple snacking episodes during the day. Robert Parlberg tackles the concept of exceptionalism and abundance in his witty volume, The United States of Excess, Gluttony and the Dark Side of American Exceptionalism. Parlberg has spent decades examining the relationships between agricultural production, international trade, and food insecurity, and provides a unique view of American exceptionalism, one that causes the reader to ponder how economics and history affect cultural behaviors and social outcomes. Parlberg argues that cheap and abundant energy, in the form of oil, gas, and electricity, and food, have incentivized the American public to use as much of these commodities as possible. Facilitating this high usage are failures of the American governance system, because the multiple layers and regional governments can easily veto and block any regulatory action designed to inhibit usage or intake. In addition to having the highest rates of obesity, the United States has the highest rate of per capita CO2 emissions, roughly twice that of other developed wealthy nations. Parlberg argues that high usage patterns of food and energy are culturally intertwined and emblematic of cultural values in general, and that they interact within a cultural belief system that produces citizens who are distinct from the citizens of other rich countries due to their mistrust of government authority, the value they place on individual versus social responsibility, their readiness to embrace religion, and also their unusual optimism about what science and technology can provide. Together, these cultural values and constructs block attempts to moderate food and fuel consumption on the national level. Parlberg also argues that because of an individual focus on responsibility and causality, Americans are more likely to embrace adaptation, treatment, over mitigation, prevention, and will opt for more medical treatments plus physical accommodation and social acceptance for those who become overweight. The combination of resistance to governmental public health interventions and the tendency to view health problems and obesity as a failure of personal responsibility means that most adults oppose taxes on sugary beverages, yet are equally likely to be on a personal diet, to have bariatric surgery, or to take weight loss drugs. Parlberg sums up this disconnect with a damning quote at the end of the book. In response to climate change, America pivots toward adaptation to protect itself and itself alone. With obesity, America's embrace of personal rather than governmental responsibility works well enough for the nation's more fortunate citizens, those better educated to avoid the condition and better able to afford medical treatments. For Americans with less education and fewer resources, particularly disadvantaged minorities, personal responsibility without stronger public policy action will remain inadequate. Parlberg tells us why Americans are so willing to embrace individualized diet and exercise plans rather than to support public health programs, and indirectly explains why fad diets are so prevalent in the United States. Being thin is a signifier of class and ethnicity, of being a winner in American culture. Diet, the body, identity, and citizenship. That the lithe body is a personification of the good citizen is explored in Helen Zoe Veit's remarkable volume, Modern Food, Moral Food, Self-Control, Science, and the Rise of Modern American Eating in the Early 20th Century. Her argument adds dimension to the examination of diet fads because she brings together multiple lines of evidence to explain how a thin body became a symbol of good citizenship, morality, self-discipline, and perceived intellectual and spiritual value. She locates the articulation point around 1910, when fashions changed to emphasize leaner lines. Nutrition science alerted consumers to the value and dangers of calories, and the soon-to-follow food conservation campaigns of World War I encouraged decreased consumption so that food could be sent abroad to feed the troops and our wartime allies. As she explains, the administration clearly saw the food conservation campaign as an opportunity to champion the moral values of austerity, and they drew parallels between righteous physical self-control and individual capacity for political self-control. These campaigns also embraced anti-modernity sentiments by channeling nostalgia for a past, presumed simpler time, and equating Puritan and pioneer diets with the morality and the austerity needed to win the war. Food reformers were convinced that good nutrition was essential to the individual body as well as the national economy, and that poor nutrition threatened national security. These reformers also linked self-control, moral righteousness, and asceticism with the body, personal, and politic. The good person, the good citizen, was disciplined, economically powerful, patriotic, and above all, thin. The need for slimness, which might not be achieved by altering food intake or thinking one was reducing food intake, created a cultural space for fad diets promising weight reduction. In the past, fad diets might have promised better digestion, such as Fletcherism.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.